Sarah, Steve, and others. We're doing some work on prescription drug abuse on campus, and invite you guys to get connected with us and learn more about some of those efforts today, and we can talk to you about some of those after the meeting if you like. I'm going to read to you first, by way of introduction for Steve, I'm going to read to you from the WhiteHouse.gov Office of National Drug Control Policy website. It says, Introducing the 2014 Advocates for Action. Across America, individuals are doing extraordinary things to improve the health and safety of their communities, whether it's developing groundbreaking programs to break the cycle of drug use and crime, conducting innovative research that expands our understanding of how drugs affect the human body, expanding treatment opportunities, and preventing drug use before it starts. The 2014 ONDCP Advocates for Action are making a difference by reducing drug use and its consequences. Dr. Steve Lloyd was named a 2014 Advocate for Action by the ONDCP this year. He's one of nine. He was recently in the White House, sitting in the Roosevelt Room next to the Drug Czar, wondering how in the world this happened. That's a pretty cool story. I'm sure you'll mention that today. Steve's a local product. Grew up in Jonesboro. Was a Crockett grad and went to Tennessee, UTK, and then came back, went to Quinlan. He's associate professor at Quinlan and associate chief of staff for education at the VA. As a tireless advocate for action, a good friend and colleague, one of my favorite people on the planet, and one of my favorite speakers to listen to. So without further ado, Steve, take it away.
All right. Thanks, Rob. That was kind. I got a whole bunch of bad stuff, if you want to run through that. Can somebody?
Do you want?
There's no way I'll be able to stand there. I've got many personality flaws and character defects and the ability to stand behind the podium I do not possess. I'm going to do something that I hadn't planned on doing. I'm going to address something through this talk that I've already gotten one question about. I'm going to talk about Suboxone. And I'm going to tell you up front, it's the best option that we've ever had to treat opiate addiction. It's not even close. But it's being bastardized and used in the community in ways that make it very hard to get people access to treatment. I can tell you that in the 2013 ONDCP, which is Office of National Drug Control Policy strategic plan for the coming year, and it'll be that way in 2014, was actually to increase access to buprenorphine and buprenorphine type agents. And so I'm going to address that, but I want everybody to ask yourselves a question right now. I'm going to ask for a show of hands. Is addiction a real disease, or is it a moral defect? Okay? And be honest with yourself, because forever and ever I thought it was a moral defect. And I wasn't surprised when I wound up with the disease of addiction. At the time, I didn't know it was a disease because I had plenty of moral defects, and it fit right in with what I thought. But if you answer that question that it's a disease, then there's no denying that buprenorphine is an excellent choice, just like treating a diabetic with insulin, no different. If it's a moral choice or a moral failing, then we're going to lose a lot of people in the process because we hang on to that. And I can prove it to you any way that you would like it proved. This is my disclaimer slide. I don't accept commercial support from anybody for anything. When I go do talks, I never take money, and I don't let people pay me in any form. Those are the things I do right now. I'm the current chief of medicine at the Mountain Home VA Medical Center, but my real job is I'm the associate chief of staff for education there and a Quillen alum, proud alum. I've been an expert witness for the U.S. Attorney, the Tennessee Bureau of Investigation, the FBI, the DEA, the IRS, the Tennessee Board of Medical Subspecialties or Specialties, and the Commonwealth Attorneys for Virginia and Kentucky. I serve as an expert witness in federal drug cases against doctors, nurse practitioners, and physician's assistants for improperly prescribing controlled substances. I've done that for about 8 years now. I'm a member of the Greene County Drug Court under Judge Ken Bailey. I've done that for about a year and a half. And drug courts are the biggest tool that we have to reduce recidivism in the United States. And hopefully we will get a criminal court judge here at some point that will look at drug courts as opposed to locking more people up. That has failed miserably so far. I'm the founding partner and chair, and the chairman of High Point Clinic, Clinic in Johnson City. My interest is in treating opiate-addicted pregnant women. I have about 33 active pregnant women right now that are opiate-addicted. I told Tom Jernigan, the chair of our OBGYN department at school, I have more active pregnant women than they do. And guys, I'm scratching the surface. There's way more of them out there than anybody in this room wants to realize. I am recovering from addiction to opiates and benzodiazepines and alcohol since July 2004. I've been in remission since that day, and for that I'm grateful. I'm a Tennessee Vol fan, alum, father to Heath and Haley. Heath is a 19-year-old sophomore at UT. My daughter Haley is 17. She went on her first car date the other night. I didn't kill the dude, so I'm still recovering a little bit from that one. And me and my wife Karen, that's no longer true. We've now been married 24 years. Our wedding anniversary was March 31st. At the end of this, I hope we can understand a little bit about the neurobiological basis of addiction disease, and I'm going to show you just the surface of what I know and understand. And I encourage you to keep reading, because we're in an age of development right now when it comes to research on the brain. That we're learning things at an exponential rate, and it's so neat to see it all come together. It really does matter, bonding with a mother and a child. If that bonding doesn't take place, then that's actually a predisposing risk factor to abuse opiates in the future, and I think that's really neat stuff. That's one thing, one reason that I know this disease. I'm going to help you understand how opiates, methamphetamines, and cocaine will make you forget your kids. I'm also going to teach you, what those of you with teenagers, why they're stupid. Okay, and there is a reason for that. We'll give you a brief overview of prescription drug abuse nationally and here in our state. We're going to identify some red flags for potential misuse and diversion of controlled substances. And help you identify some strategies to protect yourself as well as help your patients. And then we're going to do an over-prescribing case review. I'll tell you before we get to that, and I'll tell you right now, the prescriber that I reviewed here, he's in practice today. I'm going to Knoxville later today, and I will drive by his office, and it'll be open, and there'll be cars in the parking lot. And I reviewed this thing about 4 years ago, and I didn't make anything in it up. So when you, I want to encourage you to be open to working with law enforcement. I have not worked with any of these guys that sniffed under anybody's doors, not one of them. If they come to you, there's a problem. So I think you'll see their frustration when I go over this case. All right, let's go to the next one. Sorry. Guys, this is how I live my life. I've lived my life this way for almost 10 years now. It's worked out pretty well, so I'm going to continue to live it that way. This is the Stockdale paradox. And I may make some people in the room mad because I confront some of, or maybe say things that are against what you feel are absolute truths. And I apologize for that, but I don't know any other way to do it. The Stockdale paradox is they'll confront the most brutal facts of our current reality, whatever they might be, while at the same time retaining faith will prevail in the end, regardless of the difficulties. And I do that with everything, and I do that with myself. I'm in the College of Nursing. I don't know how many nurse practitioners we have in the room. I would assume that we have at least a few. If you look at the top 50 in the prescribers in the state of Tennessee last year for controlled substances, there was a significant number of them that were nurse practitioners and physician's assistants. I don't care about the percentage. I don't care about was it more or the data was correct. That is completely irrelevant. What is relevant is we're not teaching you enough in your training about identification of addictive disease nor prescribing controlled substances for either acute or chronic pain. That is the problem. It's not about blaming it. It's more the doctors. Oh, these are all mid-levels. I could give a crap. I can tell you we're losing 3 Tennesseans a day to accidental drug overdose. That's number 6 in the United States. That's what I care about. Next. Here's a prevailing philosophy. If you look at the treatment for drug addiction and alcoholism in the United States, this is Kurt Vonnegut, the writer. It's obviously from the Reagan era. Here's the solution to the American drug problem suggested by the wife of our president. Just say no. Right? And those of us in the room that are old enough all remember that campaign. And I will not argue that that will work 100% of the time when you try it. Right? But that's not our current reality. It's like kids, and you talk to them about premarital sex and all the things that can happen. And I'm all for doing that. I'm also for teaching them about contraception. All right, and that'll get me kicked out of certain aspects of my family, but I'm sorry. It's just the way it is. I've seen many a pregnancy that's a virgin birth, right off the toilet seat, right? So I'm going to hedge my bet and teach people about contraception. This one is fairly similar. We had over 900 babies born drug addicted in our state last year. There was an article in the newspaper, I guess it was about 2 years ago in March and April, and it was from interviews with our neonatologist here at John City Medical Center, whom I like very much. And they said, if you're a pregnant woman and you're currently taking Suboxone or Subutex, get off of these drugs now. That's malpractice. I don't know any other way to say it. Would you rather them go back to sticking needles in their arm? I don't know how you could come up with that statement. And then when questioned further, one of them said, well, these women don't need to be getting pregnant in the first place. Thank you. That's a big help. Okay, I don't know what to say about that either. Not exactly rocket science. So I'm going to try to take a look at some things that we can do a little better job at. No other subject brings out people's venom like this one. It's unbelievable. So I was in California with my dad, and I was going to do a talk to the pharmacy fraud investigators, healthcare fraud investigators in Los Angeles. And I already had my talk ready to go and ready for the next morning. And I sat down at night and read the LA Times, and there's a huge article in there on prescription drug abuse. I couldn't believe it. So I went online and I read the rest of the article. I watched the interviews with the folks who had lost their children, they'd lost their sons, they'd lost their daughters, just like here in East Tennessee in the Appalachians. And I made the mistake of reading what the booger eaters said at the bottom. And y'all know who I'm talking about with the booger eaters. And the booger eaters are the people that blog in at the bottom that don't have a job, and they're sitting in their mom and dad's basement, and they got the answers to the world. They tell you how to coach a football team. They tell you how to run the United States. I try not to read most of those idiots, but it's almost like the bug flying at the blue light. I can't resist. These were some of the comments. How about treatment that works instead of some ridiculous 12-step AA-NA cult higher power nonsense that has a 100% failure rate? Well, that's not entirely true. It doesn't have a 100% failure rate, but I think we need to look at other treatment options because it doesn't work for everybody, and I am a product of 12-step recovery. It doesn't work for everybody. Addiction is the only disease that I know of that whenever the patient fails or relapses, that it's the patient's fault. It'd be like me having a kidney failure patient come in here. I'll give you a better example. Heart failure patient, the day after Christmas. Comes in short of breath, legs are swollen up. Doc, I'm in bad shape. I put him in the hospital. I give him Lasix. He ate a bunch of salt. Right? I don't tell him, you stupid son of a bitch, stop eating country ham. What are you thinking? And send him out the door. But that's what we do with people with addictive disease all the time. And I'll tell you that it's wrong. Pain management specialists are hard to come by and not covered by my insurance. Many physicians will not treat my pain properly and threaten me with no medication. This is the flip side of it. All right, now I'm assuming that this is a legitimate patient, but we know we get some that are not, and they use this ruse. But I'm assuming this one's legitimate. We get the old person who is diagnosed with cancer and has metastasis to their bones, and they're scared to death to take the oxycodone because they've heard about people being addicted to it. Right, so you can't address just one side of this thing. You've got to take a multi-pronged approach, and that's why I love my friends in the College of Public Health. And then the last one kind of offended me personally. It says 99% of addicts are personality disordered. They are mentally retarded. And so when I read that the first time, my first thought is, you know, I'd like to take that person out back and drag them around the parking lot. The second thought is, it's sad because this is somebody whose life has been touched by addictive disease, more than likely a loved one. I went to the city planning or town planning meeting in Bayleton, Tennessee last night. There's a doctor here in Johnson City that's wanting to open up a Suboxone clinic in Bayleton, and the citizens have rallied against this, and they had their meeting last night. And I can't vouch for the validity of the clinic. I don't know if he's going to do it right or if he's not going to do it right. I've got no clue. But I went on behalf of the people who are seeking treatment and can't get it. And if you read some of the comments in the paper when they had their first meeting, you get a little bit of flavor of this. One of the faithful of Bayleton said that Jesus wouldn't help the alcoholic by standing behind the bar. I beg to differ. I think that he would. One person said, what was the comment I wanted to get it exactly right. Some of these people, they have the AIDS. Now, that's 1980s, early 1980s thinking. And those of you who are old enough to remember that, we had that. People wouldn't let their kids swim in the swimming pool with somebody else who may or may not have HIV disease. And it was, people always wanted to know how you got it. Did you get it from drug abuse? Were you a male homosexual? As if somehow those things justified it being okay that you got it. If that's the way it works, I want out. I don't want any part of anything like that. And addiction is the only other thing that I know that will stir people up to these kind of emotions. If I ask myself why, I know why. If you look at the number of people in the United States who have the disease of addiction, and you say that they touched 7 people in their lives, that means that 75% of the people in our country have been affected by addictive disease. And it goes for this room right here. And you never see anybody get better. So when I got fortunate enough to go to rehab 10 years ago, and the people who helped me, the president of my university, Paul Stanton, didn't fire me. Ron Franks, my dean, didn't fire me. Matter of fact, they paid me the whole time I was gone. And they gave me a chance. And when I got back, my patients didn't know where I was. And I decided I'm not going to hide. And I haven't hidden. And it's I'm really glad that I have it. If you have to live in the shadows, it's a shame. People with diabetes don't have to live in the shadows. People with hypertension don't have to live in the shadows. And it's the stigma of addiction that keeps us sick. All right, first things first, let's separate the two, dependence from addiction. I'm going to tell you why I hate most methadone clinics, although methadone has a 70% mortality benefit. So if I go out and I got 1,000 addicts laying on the street, they got heroin needles sticking out of their arm, and I don't do anything but go out and drop methadone in their mouth every morning. That's it. I don't even know their name. I improve their mortality rate by 70%. I want somebody to argue to me with me how that's a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. Preserving life is never a bad thing. What we can do with that is a little different, but some places absolutely need to be shut down. And I'll tell you a story as we go along with this. Dependence, right off the bat, dependence is once the drug is stopped, a predictable physiologic withdrawal syndrome happens. You get dope sick. I can get the Pope dependent in 14 days. He may not have an addictive gene in his body, but it doesn't matter. And when I stop the hydrocodone or the oxycodone that I've had him on 4 or 5 times a day, he's going to get dope sick, just like the heroin addict laying out there shooting in his neck vein. Okay, exactly the same, no different. Does that mean he's an addict? No, it doesn't. Does it mean he's an addict? It means he's dependent, and he will adjust, and he will get better. What separates dependence from addiction is the phenomenon of craving. Okay, and guys, I stand up here, got on a nice bow tie. I think I'm looking pretty suave today. I drive a nice car. I live in a nice neighborhood. I have the disease of addiction. I still have cravings. It's been 10 years. I've had the best help money can buy. I've had an unbelievable support system. I still have it. All right? Jim Thigpen would let me drive his kids around in my car, I think. Okay? My friends, trust me, I still have cravings. You can't forget that. Okay? Because what we want to do is we want to treat addiction. And we want to say, okay, you go here for 28 days, you come back, and you do this right down the line, and you're going to be fine. Does anybody know where the 28-day treatment program came from? Insurance companies, because that's what they would pay for. So that's what I want to do is rely on some pencil pushers and an actuary table so they can maximize their profits. I believe that they're right about the 28-day treatment program. It's complete horse crap. You do have to treat addiction long-term. And sometimes for people who don't have the advantage of having the psychotherapy that I had, the cognitive behavioral therapy that I have and continue to have today, medication may be the best thing they ever have. It may be the best they ever do. But if they're not sticking needles in their arm and they're not transmitting HIV disease and hepatitis C, and they're able to hold down a job, and they're able to get their family back, tell me what's wrong with that. I got a guy I found in my parking lot a couple of years ago. His name's Michael. He wasn't even a patient. I looked at him. He was obviously dope sick. I've seen it a few times. I gave him the money to come and see me for the first 6 months. Michael, last year, I got his kids back. He has a job. He has an apartment. He had enough money for Christmas presents. And he hasn't been in jail in the past 2 years. How is that bad? Okay, are we going to hold on to the things that we've held on to forever and say that it's a moral problem and we shouldn't be doing this? Or are we going to, it's not the answer. It's a harm reduction model, but I'm telling you, it's the best option that we have right now. Now, the phenomenon of craving. I've been clean 8 years at the time. I flew to Austin, Texas. I was going to fly down there, do my talk the next morning, and fly back because Science Hill had a baseball game that afternoon, and I think Jim remembered this day. because I was pissed. I was a little bit late. But I was going to fly back home right after I did my talk so I could make our baseball game. And I was literally going to be on the ground about 12 hours. I got to my hotel that night. It was late. I walked out. It was right in the middle of Austin, Texas. That's where the University of Texas is. Not a good place for country boy Stevie Lloyd. So I walked to the pizza place and over to my right, I saw a house. And I saw the people outside the house. I've seen that before. I know what I'm looking at. And I had a craving. It's the first time I'd had one in a long time. I'm in Austin, Texas. I'm away from everybody. Who in the world is going to know, right? But I've got 8 years of a solid recovery behind me with people I can trust, and I knew what to do. I went and got my piece of pizza. I went back to my hotel room, made a couple of phone calls, went to bed. I had a moment of clarity because I was speaking to a group of DEA agents the next day, and I thought it would probably be a good thing if I would. So I did have a moment of clarity, and I got up the next morning. I did my talk. I flew home. They wouldn't take off from Charlotte because the bathroom door wouldn't shut. It's a 20-minute flight. Hold it. I didn't do that, and I was about 20 minutes late for a baseball game. But I have cravings. Now, I want you to tell me how the folks that we see who don't have access to the things that I have access to are going to be able to deal with that situation. They're not. And what medication does, it also crushes the cravings. Now I'm talking about, guys, I'm not talking about people who are taking the medication, crushing it up and shooting it in their veins. I'm talking taking it as prescribed by a provider who knows the disease of addiction and doesn't have his shingle hung outside to collect $100 bills on a weekly basis. Okay, I want you to afford me that opportunity to separate the two groups because to me, they're pond scum. Addiction is defined by the phenomenon of cravings, but it's a compulsive use, loss of control, and continued use despite adverse consequences. So here's the scenario. Tell me which of the following is the best predictor for chronic alcoholism. Is it a liver failure? Is it jaundice? Is it the second DUI? Or is it your wife kicked you out of the house for good? Which one is it? It's the second DUI. All right. It's the second DUI. The first DUI, you may be a little skinny woman that didn't have enough to eat at the restaurant, had one too many glasses of wine, you got pulled over. It happens. I'm not saying it's okay. It happens. The second DUI is not an accident. You've done been in the busted paper, right? You've done had your photo in every mini mart in the Tri-Cities area. You spent 48 hours in jail. The second DUI is not an accident. And that is the continued use despite adverse consequences. That's how you separate the two. Now, back to the methadone clinic thing for just a second. I had a young guy from up in Kentucky. He was a college baseball player. He went to Pikeville College. His sophomore year, tore his ACL. It was complicated by a couple of infections postoperatively. Never smoked pot, never drank alcohol. Family history was null for addictive disease. Not a victim of abuse. His doctor puts him on Lortab postoperatively. He continues it postoperatively. It was a little bit longer because of the infection. And then whenever he stopped the Lortab, he went into withdrawals. His family doctor said, oh, you're addicted, and sent him to the methadone clinic, who was there to collect $100 bills and who kept him on methadone for the next 12 years until I got him about a year. To me, that's tragic. Never mentioned anything to him about living his life a different way, the fact that he may not be have addictive disease. He may have just been physiologic dependent, which I can tell you he turned out to be. I wanted to detox it. So call up the local place. We're right here next to Woodard Hospital. If you don't believe me, call them up and ask them. I've got a patient here with no insurance. He's IV drug addicted. I'd like to get him a detox. Tell me how I can do that. He doesn't have any insurance. They're going to say $2,500 to $5,000 up front. If you want any kind of treatment, it's going to be about $10,000 a month up front. Guys, it might as well be $2 billion. People do not have access to it. All right, everybody got dependence? Okay, next one. All right, so we're going to learn a little bit about the brain. I love this. This is cool stuff. If you taught neuroanatomy like this, Dave, I'd been all over. Not you personally. Dave Linville is our Dean of Graduate Medical Education, so I'll allow to sling a few barbs at Dave, but he's a really good guy. All right, go back to the Skinner box. We've all seen this at some point in our training. Mouse presses on the top lever. He gets food and water. He presses on the bottom lever. He's standing on chicken wire. You see his little mouse face crinched up there. He got a jolt of electricity. It didn't take the little mouse long, even with his little mouse brain, to learn to press the top lever. Some graduate students a few years later took this concept a little bit further. By then, we had discovered what we thought was the pleasure center, reward center of the brain. We now know it as the limbic system. And it's our center for emotions. It controls memory, emotion, and then some primitive stuff like drive for sex, food, and water for propagation of the species. So these graduate students took these electrodes, put them down into the mice's reward centers, and wanted to see if exogenous stimulation of that reward center would be more powerful than the drives for food, water, and sex. Because I want you to get an understanding of what a craving is like, and I think this is the best way to tell you. So they put the mice in, they stimulated their brain, actually had a lever just like this, and if it pressed the lever, then that would stimulate the reward center of their brain. They would put mice in that were hungry, put food right beside them, and give the option to eat the food when they're hungry or press the lever to stimulate the limbic system. They did the same thing with water, and they did the same thing with a nursing female and her newborn, and then an in-heat female and a male mouse. Okay, that one sold me. Let's have a look and see what they found. You can go to the next one. How powerful was the exogenous source? Rats would press the lever 7,000 times an hour in order to stimulate the limbic system. Bang, 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 bang. Right? They preferred it over any other naturally occurring stimulus. And when I say naturally occurring stimulus, I'm talking about our drives to drink water when we're thirsty, eat food when we're hungry. And I want you to think about that for a second when I get to the bottom. They preferred it over food even when they were hungry. Food, you're hungry, lever that you can press to stimulate the reward center in your brain, and you'll sit there, the mouse would sit there, and bang, 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 bang. By the way, all this stuff's been repeated in humans. I like the mouse story. Bang, they'll forget it, right? They won't eat. So those of you who don't have very good eating habits, like myself, I wound down a Big Mac meal on the way over here right in the front of the College of Nursing, and choked down a big Coke. That's my dietary habits. If I get home at the end of the day and I hadn't eaten, I got the shakes, right, the sugar shakes, and I will eat anything. I tell every audience I'm in front of, it's the only time rice cakes are good. You cram those things in, they actually are satisfying. Think about how powerful that stimulus is, and then whenever you add opiate narcotics into this, you can multiply that by about 100. Okay, that's what kind of power we're talking about with craving. They preferred it over water, even when they were thirsty. You can keep going. Females would abandon their newborn nursing in order to press the lever. That's a biological, you know, phenomenon to me. You know, when Heath was born, I hadn't been to med school yet. It was right before I came to Quillen, and he was asleep over in his little his little bassinet or whatever it was. And Karen and I are in bed. He would start crying. I would look over at Karen, and she looked like a geyser, and he was nowhere around. She was, you know, milk was coming out. I didn't know that happened. That's what kind of physiologic bond that there is. There's not even a connection there, right? There's not a, you know, not a physical connection. The baby's way over there. Yeah, the mom can hear her baby crying and suddenly produce milk to feed it. It's the most amazing thing. Females would just totally turn that off and sit there and hit the lever and let their newborn be hungry. Males would ignore females in heat in order to press the lever. Now, if I didn't believe any of the other stuff was powerful, this one, come on, I would die. That's unbelievable, right? Think about how powerful that is. And guys, I experienced all this. As I was taking opiates from the outside suppressed my body's own ability to make my own opiates, endogenous opiates. We know them as endorphins or enkelfins. And they're released when we do things that give us pleasure. I watched the University of Tennessee score a touchdown. It's been a while. Okay, Peerless Priceman in 98 was pretty sweet. My endorphins and kelphins are popping out like crazy, and I've got an overall sense of well-being. That is our natural reward system. When you take stuff from the outside, you suppress your body's ability to do that. So if you're taking opiates, and you've got opiate receptors here, and the opiate's attached to it, and downstream dopamine comes out in your reward center of your brain, that's the basis. So if you're taking opiates, the more you take, the more receptors your body makes. And the more receptors your body makes, the more drug you got to take to fill those receptors up. Now here's the kicker. The dopamine receptors at the bottom, which is where the feel-good hormone is going to be released from, decrease in number. So you get an increase in the number of receptors you've got to fill, and you get a decrease in the overall feeling of well-being. Guys, that's a bad situation to be in. the last year that I used narcotics, I wasn't getting high. I was trying to stay alive. Getting high left a long time ago. You run a homeless shelter in Kingsport. The people that you see when they are Jones and they've got to have drugs, it's not to get high. It's to feel like a human being, I promise you. All right, where's the bottom? The rats had to be unhooked from that stimulation and to sit there and do it and die of starvation or thirst with food and water readily available. Does that sound like anything that we see? Pressing the lever became their entire world. And they said, does it sound familiar? Of course it sounds familiar. I'd almost be willing to bet you can't pick up the Johnson City Press today and not be able to find evidence of this phenomenon right now. How does a mama leave her baby in the car while she goes in to the hotel up on 11E and smokes methamphetamine? I'll tell you why. Rats pressing the lever. That's why. It is a disease of the limbic system of the brain. All right, Steve, all well and good. What's it have to do with addiction? All right, here's the feel-good hormone. It's kind of, I hated that we had to learn all of these things in school. To me, they're still completely useless. I thought they were useless back then. I could look it up on my iPhone. Tyrosine to L-dopa to dopamine. That's a process that's happening in our nerve endings. They're stored in terminals here until a stimulus comes along and causes a release of the dopamine into the synapse. And this is the reward center of the brain that we're talking about, the limbic system. Down here is the mammalian or the reptile brain. Part that we share with crocodiles. So I'm talking about this area here. The dopamine is released into this area. After it's had time to have its effect, it's re-uptake back into that nerve terminal ending for another go-around. Okay, everybody got that? Now, I want to talk about the two competing forces here in our brain, and this is why you teenagers are stupid. Okay, so right here, think of it as the go. It's the go part of our brain. I gotta have it. Gotta have food, gotta have water, gotta have sex. All right, the guys that jump out of airplanes or those idiots that say no limits and they're jumping their skateboard over Lake Michigan, these guys, the adrenaline junkies, right? It's the limbic system of their brain that drives that, okay? That's where they gotta have, that's the go. The frontal lobe of our brain here, prefrontal cortex, or all those terrible names, the frontal lobe of your brain is your stop. It's what gives you insight. It's what helps you predict the future. It's what helps you with consequences. Right? So this is the go, this is the stop. The go is not fully intertwined with the stop until we're about 22 to 23 years old. That's why you don't buy an 18-year-old the Camaro SS Supersport with 420 horsepower. Because he has no concept in the frontal lobe of his brain the consequences of driving 120 miles an hour down a country road that's designed to drive 45 miles an hour. Right, and he runs off the road and he gets killed. That's why you don't buy kids cars like that. Now, this process happens as we age normally. Right? When you start using drugs, this whole process, the connection between frontal lobe and the reward center, the go and the stop, it arrests right then. It stops. So when you're talking to somebody with the disease of addiction and they're giving you answers like a 12-year-old, stop them and say, hey, by the way, how old were you the first time you used? That's the emotional age of the person you're dealing with every time. Now, the good thing is that this thing happens really quickly if you're past 23 and you can get people clean for a little while. So I see people go into AA meetings and NA meetings, and I told you I love 12 steps, and they're just trying to get clean. And maybe they slip up, maybe whatever. And there's always a couple of folks in the crowd that feel like it's their job to beat the hell out of them. And I can tell you that's a crappy idea. For one thing, they don't have a fully functioning frontal lobe of their brain, so they don't understand the single consequence that you're telling them. And if shame worked, they'd have quit a long time ago. So stop beating them up. Okay? It's going to take about 90 days, believe it or not, for this to start to really take effect for people to wake up. Okay, so we've got to stop using shame. The sheriff out in Arizona wants to put pink stuff or pink clothes on his DUI guys and have them clean up on the side of the road. It won't work, and it'll make the shame worse. Stop doing it. I don't know another field of medicine that lay people who know nothing think they know more about and they know better than the scientists who research it. It makes me crazy if you can't tell. All right, so let me tell you how I know my patients are getting better. I'm a dude, I've got to go at a stop just like anybody else. So if I'm walking down the street and I look over and I see the Victoria's Angels supermodel coming at me with the wings, the limbic system in my brain goes, reproduce, all right? Humans are the only mammalian species that doesn't reproduce. So, but if we did, bang, over there, right? That's my drive in my limbic system. But I'm 46 years old. I've been in remission from drug addiction for a good while now. I have a functioning frontal lobe in my brain. I know consequences. Number one, my wife is mean, okay? And she would turn me in to John Wayne Bobbitt, and that would be it. Number two, whatever put us here didn't put her here just for my benefit. And when my patients start to see things like that, then I know they're starting to wake up. I see my patients say, tell me about driving drunk, and suddenly realize that it wasn't just them, it was other people that get hurt. I see them starting to wake up. I know the direction I'm headed in. I know the frontal lobe is starting to wake up, and now we can try to make some positive change. All right. But people that we see come out of places where they've been abused, they come out of families that are broken. You would not believe the rate of incest in our area. It's off the charts. Okay, they have had nothing in their life that they could hang their hat on. So beating them up, shaming them, ain't going to work, I promise you. Opiates, I'll skip this part because I need to speed up a little bit. How do you let this happen? Right, this is a worker. These are MRSA abscesses from skin popping. That's IV drug abuse. He's going to work every day. It's rats hitting the lever, ignoring food and hygiene. They didn't see anything wrong with this. Matter of fact, I tried to talk them out of sticking the needle directly into the abscess, into their veins. Have to do it all the time. Next picture. This one's one that walked into my office. This is a pregnant gal. She came in. She had her hands in a hooded sweatshirt, and I smelled something. Usually you don't want to smell something in your office when you're seeing patients. And I pulled her hand out of there. She had it wrapped up. I unwrapped it. This is what I found. This is her thumb, and I'm sorry I took it with my iPhone, but this whole part here is just extremely erythematous, and obviously it will auto-amputate. She had been shooting dope, and she's pregnant. She'd been shooting dope into her anatomic snuff box right here, the little vein that goes over the top of it. She doesn't want to go to the doctor because the doctor will find out she's drug addicted, and since it's a moral failing, she's an even bigger piece of shit than she thinks she is, and she can't take that. Plus, the mean people will take her baby before it's even born, so she goes to a guy up in Kentucky, which is where she's from, who will treat this for her. Keep in mind, he's not a doctor, and he'll treat it for money, drugs, or sex. And so he basically goes to his workshop or his kitchen and gets a knife and runs some hot water on it and lances it and drains it and then packs it. Well, there's something called anaerobes, and if it's an anaerobe causing that infection and you pack it, you might as well pour cow manure in it, which is what I suspect here because I smelled it. She'll lose her hand. I took this picture to Tim Bilal, who's the attorney for Mountain States, and I explained to him why this picture mattered to him because this is a young person, and they're going to not seek medical care because of the stigma associated with it and how we've treated them in the past, and they're finally going to show up in your ED when they're septic. And then they're going to have a heart valve out of your mouth. You're going to have endocarditis. You're going to spend a week in your ICU. And you're probably going to have to replace the valve, which is another week in your ICU post-operatively, and then a few days on the floor to recover from that. And guess what? They ain't got any insurance. Guys, you're going to pay for it on the front end or back end. I would advocate that we pay for it on the front end and treat it. Underground healthcare, guys, this is the other side of it. That's what's left of her nail bed. I thought when I first met her or first started treating her that I thought she would lose her arm. I treated this and streeted it, believe it or not, with right off the Walmart $4 drug list, which is the best I could do. And she actually didn't lose her hand. This part is pretty much gone, auto-amputated, fell off. All right, I love this picture. Age 28, age 37. I would submit to you here, even before the drug use, this looks bad to me. That's somebody who's lost. 75% of all females who have addictive disease have been physically, emotionally, or sexually abused. I think that number is closer to 99.99. I have yet to find one. I hope they're out there, but I haven't found them yet. So she looks lost in the first picture. After 10 years of methamphetamine use, she died at age 38. Rats ignoring food and hygiene despite being hungry and thirsty. Okay. Why does proper prescribing matter? First of all, it's a missed opportunity to help patients. Impact on our healthcare system. Look at your hospital censuses. If you know what you're looking at, and Patrick, you're still an inpatient doc, you look at your census every day and I know what the diagnosis is, how many of those are secondary to substance abuse. I'd be shocked if it ever falls below 25%. Impact on the criminal justice system, and then it's a major cause for increasing incidence of heroin. Rob, I found this right before I came in here. From 2007 to 2011, heroin users in the United States more than doubled in a four-year time period. The state of Kentucky is being riddled with heroin right now. Guys, if you just cut off the source or just make it so hard that people don't have access to narcotic, they'll do something else, okay? At some point, you're going to have to go with primary and secondary prevention. There's no other way, I promise you. Next slide. Economic impact, you can just run those all the way through. They're big, right? It's like the national debt. I see that thing has no effect on me. It's so big I can't comprehend it, so I don't care. It's big, right? Look at those numbers. And of all of that, and guys, everything I give you, I didn't swag it. I didn't make it up. It's all referenced. It'll be at the bottom of the slide. The source here is the Clinical Journal of Pain. Five drugs, OxyContin, oxycodone, hydrocodone, propoxyphene, and methadone accounted for 2/3 of the economic burden. Next, substance abuse nationally. You can throw them up here because I need to speed up a little. Our drug overdoses increased by 400% in the last decade. More people die of overdoses now in the United States than they do from car crashes. We got about 12 million Americans reporting non-medical use in 2010. And the last point on this slide is a humdinger. The United States is less than 5% of the world's population, but we consume 80% of the world's opiate supply. We love opiates. Prescription drug abuse. We've got more Americans abusing prescription drugs than cocaine, I can't say the second word, heroin, and inhalants combined. And drug overdose deaths are the same way. Opiates more than everything else put together. In 2010, we had enough prescription painkillers to medicate every American adult around the clock for a month. Amazing. I love this one as well. For every one death, and guys, when you see these, they're about more than you can take. Right? It's always somebody young. For me, everyone that I wind up seeing winds up being a young female who's been beat to death with a carjack at the Blue Hole in, above Stony Creek. Okay, that's where this happens. And people, when they put their obituary in the paper, they don't say they got beat to death with a carjack at the Blue Hole in Stony Creek. Okay, but you see those young people, this is how they're dying. We got 10 admissions for abuse, 32 ED visits, 130 people who abuse or are dependent, 825 non-medical users. Guys, the numbers are staggering. Is there any trainees in the room? I know pharmacy's back there. Any nursing trainees in the room? How much have you learned in your nursing training up to this point about proper prescribing, the control substance, and the disease of addiction?
Very little. What I've learned on my own because of Capstone.
This will be the biggest thing you see in practice, and it won't be close. And it's amazing to me, and I came through medical school and residency, that's a lot of years, on the proper prescribing of narcotics and the treatment of both chronic and acute pain, I got 0 hours. Now, I want you to contrast that with veterinarians. Veterinarians have about 75 hours in their formal curriculum on pain. We have 0 hours. And the pain literature, I tell you, we have is bogus because it's funded by the pharmaceutical industry. And I wouldn't trust them to tell me that the sun is high up in the sky. Next, not that I have any feelings on that. All right, these are Tennessee's numbers, and they're staggering as well. The second one here, we prescribe enough opiates and controlled substances so that every person above the age of 12 could have 51 pills of hydrocodone, 22 pills of Xanax, 21 pills of oxycodone. Amazing. We have 887 prescription drug overdoses in 2010. That means we're losing 3 Tennesseans a day to accidental drug overdose. And then the last point on this slide should be NAS. In 2013, we had more than 900 babies born in our state with neonatal abstinence syndrome. Everybody agrees it's a big problem. Here's another way of putting it. Those are accidental drug overdose deaths, and you see their climb from 1999 to 2011. I'll get through this. I love this next year's slide. Hold on right here. So this is us, opioid prescription rates by county in 2007. Red is bad, okay? It's like the Republican Party coming across the state of Tennessee. So I'm sorry about that. Wheel through these. Boom. And then there's Opiate Nation. And Tennessee is the nice, deep shade of red. The only other places are like that. are basically in South Florida and some places out west. Our whole state is like that. Even West Virginia managed a little pink. So amazing. And this is from the Tennessee Department of Health, and basically Dr. Drosner's triangle, which I believe in. To address the problem, we have buyers, sellers, and potential buyers. Buyers are our patients, sellers are us. Potential buyers are the ones to follow. And how do we address that? Treatment, control, and prevention. If you just address one arm of this thing, you squeeze it in the other directions and you drop it into the black market. All right, I want to address the black market for a second. I want to address Suboxone again real quick right here. I hear all the time law enforcement say, we've got a scourge of Suboxone on the streets. Okay, when you see that, why don't you ask yourself a question and say, why? Has there been any research done on this subject? Yes, there has. And the research has shown that Suboxone's price on the street is driven by lack of availability of clinics that can help you. Okay, so it becomes more valuable to go and get it, sell it on the street if you don't have access to be able to get it. One of the national drug control strategies is to increase access so we can drop that demand. People getting Suboxone off the street, for the large majority, are trying to stay off dope. There are going to be some abusers. There just are. The hardest doctor I ever worked with in my life who was abusing indomethacin, guys. It's an NSAID. Okay, it flips a trigger in some people's brain. Who knows? There are going to be people who do abuse it, but that number is low. And it's like people in a room looking at an elephant. If you put people all around the elephant, tell them to describe what they see, it ain't going to sound anything like an elephant. You got to look at the big view. I've got people in law enforcement that all they ever see is the people that get in trouble with it. I've got people over here who all they ever see is the places that run a bad deal. Okay? You don't get to see what I get to see. You don't get to see people's lives changing. One of my patients came to clinic not long ago, and they're not allowed to come whenever they don't have an appointment because I have to teach you boundaries. And he had his kids in the car, and he said, I hope you'll be all right with this. I wanted to stop by and thank you, Doc. He had his kids in the car. They had Mickey Mouse ears on. For Christmas, he got him a trip to Disney World. All right, and he said, 2 years ago, I was stealing money from him. I didn't have a job. There's nothing wrong with that. So don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. So my friend Tommy Farmer, Tommy's the head of the Tennessee Methamphetamine Prescription Drug Task Force. He's got a shake and bake meth lab here in front of him. You can roll through these, they're pretty quick. When Tommy was a kid, I'm sure he wanted to be a real G-man, right? Flat top, sunglasses, big bags of dope. Although in Colorado, this is a trip to the grocery store. Guns, bags of dope, bad guys, right? Headline material, right? Barney Fife would be on the front of the Mayberry paper with all that dope. But that's not the world that we're living in right now. This guy doesn't look like Tony Montana from Scarface, right? Your country dog. This doesn't look like a dope deal gone bad. This is a hand to show with a little rheumatism in her shoulder. In Whitesburg, Kentucky, you can go up there, and about every person that age more than likely will have an ample supply of hydrocodone to purchase from them if you'd like it. So if you're not checking your controlled substance monitoring data banks just because somebody is a little older, or maybe they go to church all the time and carry around their Bible, I would really encourage you to check the CSMD because I've been fooled on these and I'm pretty decent. I still get fooled. Right? I stopped down in Florida a few years ago. I pulled over in the middle of the thing to the gas station. These are everywhere. Let your fingers do the walking. Pain clinics. The state of Florida clamped down on them. State of Tennessee, we now have 296 registered pain clinics. I've probably jumped over about 300 by now. Florida is significantly lower than that. So they've done a good job. So far, we have not. You can go fast. There you go. They look like this. We walk right by them, and they're everywhere. Affordable health care, medical clinics. You see them in strip malls. These are places that are dealing. I like the distribution. Here's our major interstate systems. There's 40, 65, 75. And 81, you find them in heavy concentrations right off the major interstate routes, about a mile left or right off the interstate. They're not hard to find. Yeah. Rob gave me this slide, and I love it. You think about it, so well, people who are using or you're getting it from doctors or buying it on the streets, the majority of first-time users obtain it free from a friend or relative out of your cabinet in your house. And I can tell you, when I was using, if I came to your house and you had it in your medicine cabinet, I left with it. All right. I roll through these. I want to get to my case. I can go. Keep going. I'm running out of time. All right, guys, I want to run through the theories of why we misprescribe. We got core personality types, patient types, pharmacologic knowledge, and your professional practice system. Core personality, we're caregivers. We went into this field for a reason, and it's hard for us to say no. When people come to us, we would like them to leave to feel like that we did some good. We're also influenced by things like press gainy scores. We have hospital administrators telling us we've got to have a nice press gainy score. If we're working in the ED, and a bunch of people get mad because we don't give them the opiates that they come in for, or we don't confront them about their opiate disease or opiate addictive disease, and just give them what they want to keep our press gainy scores up. I told a room full of hospital administrators, you're going to have to get rid of this one. You can't do both here. Our patient types, guys, we live in the buckle of the OxyContin belt in the Appalachians. If I'm living in Ecuador, I ain't got to know too much. Or if I'm living in Tennessee, I don't have to know too much about TB. Pick it off a chest x-ray, maybe that's about it. If I'm living in Ecuador, I better know a crap load about TB. Okay, you got to know what's in your community. This is in our community, so you got to be able to recognize it. Pharmacologic knowledge, OxyContin, when it first came out, had a package insert, said it was actually safer to use than short-acting narcotics. Some people still believe that. We've bought, drank the drug companies' Kool-Aid on the fact that people need a long-acting opioid. It's better relief for pain and short-acting opioid for breakthrough pain. Now, guys, I never saw anybody get better on that. I saw them need a higher dose of longer-acting opioid, then they needed more for breakthrough pain, and the next thing I was doing was waiting on the disability papers to come in the mail. That's what I saw, and that's what everybody else saw as well. All right, here's our categories: the dated, the disabled, the duped, and the dysfunctional. The dated just fails to keep, dated fails to keep current, disabled, failed judgment due to their own impairment. That was me. Duped, they failed to detect deception due to time constraints, and then dysfunctional, just couldn't say no. All right, our patterns, these are what I look for when I'm going through charts. Number one, excessive number and frequency for schedule twos and threes. A crescendo pattern of drugs, 5 milligrams twice a day, 5 milligrams three times a day, 7.5 milligrams two times a day. Now I can't sleep, get a benzo added on so I can sleep. Now I'm gonna need a long-acting narcotic and keep these for breakthrough. All right, it's the same pattern, then follow it. And guys, when you get that little sick feeling in your stomach, you should know what you're looking at. Excessive dispensing, the progression to multiple drugs I've already talked about, particularly when you throw Soma in. Soma's metabolite is an opiate, okay? It potentiates the effect of Lortab and Percocet because it is metabolized to an opiate itself. Inadequate records, never ever prescribed for family members. I don't care what it's for, not strep throat, not anything. I did this. Born and raised in Jonesboro, I made it to college and med school. They didn't have any idea where I was during all those years. Didn't care if I had food or anything. I got a DEA number. My damn phone didn't stop ringing. They didn't even know Johnny, your cousin, and we don't want to spend $75 to do this. Can you call him in some penicillin? Oh, sure, that's no problem. I didn't want him to think I'd outgrown my raisin. The next call I got, your Uncle Kenny called the office today and couldn't get you Xanax. Now you're screwed. Stop it before it starts. My life is so much better, and I don't have to talk to them because I didn't like them anyway. Red flags, people that feign physical, psychological problems, pressuring you for a specific drug, presents a dramatic and compelling but vague complaint. These are your fibromyalgia type patients. All right, and fibromyalgia is a real disease. It's not just something that middle-aged women get when their husbands don't find them interesting anymore. It is real, okay? However, it does not cause disability, and the treatment for it is not a fentanyl patch with Oxy-30s for breakthrough. It's not. It's exercise. It's cognitive behavioral therapy. It's maybe an antidepressant, although I hate drugs in general. It's not opiate narcotics. The last one's mine, allergy to Toradol. Let me tell you about my favorite complaint that I ever saw, dramatic and compelling. This guy, John Hancock, he's the first doctor we successfully prosecuted in the state. He had a patient that says his chief complaint was, it takes me 8 hours to get out of bed in the morning. Think about that. That is unbelievable. It's not possible. You've got things all through the chart. Shows the guy riding horses, riding four-wheelers out across his yard. That's a dramatic and compelling but vague complaint that doesn't hold water. These are the people that I raise an eyebrow about, have symptoms that contradict their clinical observation. They have no interest in the diagnosis. You order an MRI scan, you come back the next month, you don't have the MRI scan because they couldn't go get it. But they will damn sure make every appointment to get their script. I promise you they will. Rejects all forms of treatment that don't involve narcotics. There's no way they'll go to physical therapy. Or they'll always have an excuse of why they couldn't go. Insurance won't pay for it, can't get a ride, but they'll show up to get their script every month. Guys, these are folks that you need to start looking at. Okay? Identifying and be able to look for A and D problems. Don't prescribe for new patients. You know, that's that's the telltale. Everybody's going to try you out, particularly for our nurse practitioner folks who get out in rural communities. You don't have anybody with you. You want to make people happy. You're in danger on this one. Record keeping by one physician. I love this one. I was on call at MEAC, Patrick, before I left. I wake up in the next morning and call the office. I didn't get a single phone call all night long. And they said, well, Dr. Wood, when some of these patients call in, they find out you're on call. They said they'll call back tomorrow. Right? But I didn't kick them out. I'll refer them about their addictive disease. Consult an addiction specialist. I'm not an addiction specialist, but I am taking the board exams in December. Check with your pharmacist and beware of medical personnel. Friends that need something from you in the office, guys, don't do it. Don't do it. The one thing I do regret is taking advantage of my friends who thought they were helping me. That's the one thing I'd love to take back. The rest of it I'll keep because I wouldn't be where I am without it. That one I'd like to take back. And if you look at the cases that we see here in Johnson City, the ones that make the newspaper, we all started with each other. So when somebody asks you about it and they're in the profession, love them enough to ask them if they're okay. All right, let's roll through these. Guys, this is just good practices. It'll be on my PowerPoint because I want to get to the case, and the case will take me less than 5 minutes. You can keep rolling. I wanted to hit you all over the head. I didn't know how much time I was going to have. All right, so this is the end. This is the case. Keep in mind, this prescriber is in practice today. In September 2006, a 26-year-old female presented to a family medicine clinic. She was previously seen in another city, first red flag. How many family medicine clinics are there? It's about 100 miles in between the two destinations. You pass 30 of them and do the same thing on the way. Why'd you go to this one? She had a diagnosis of chronic pyelonephritis. So let me explain to you what I do. I get these charts brought to me by law enforcement, sit on my desk, and that's it. And I start with day one, demographics here, and I start reading. So the only way I know it is it's in the chart. I don't even know what chronic pyelonephritis is, first of all. I know what acute pyelonephritis is, never heard of chronic. Chief complaint is my back hurts. Physical exam, right lower quadrant, left lower quadrant, suprapubic pain. What does that mean? The doctor went like this and she said, ouch. It's highly scientific. No urine drug screen was ordered. You can go to the next slide. Her past medical history, she did have acute pyelonephritis. I found that in the chart, it was in the ED. Her social history, she's married with multiple marital problems. Her husband beats her. She's now separated. She's a single mom with two children, ages 6 and 8. And her husband is skipping child support. Physical, sexual, emotional abuse, 75% of females. Husband gone, and when he is in her life, he's beating her. She's desperate for money. He's not paying her. All right, it's stacking up. Employment history. Oh, she's a CNA and a pharmacy tech, so she's in the healthcare field. Previous imaging. I didn't know what chronic pyelonephritis was, but I thought if I had an ultrasound, it'd probably be scarred if there was such a beast. Ultrasound of her kidney that I found was normal. Her current medications that she came to the doctor on, and keep in mind she left one doc to come to this doc because she wasn't happy with this. Oxy 40 three times a day, Percocet 10 four times a day, and Roxyset 30 four times a day. That's what she came on. Her clinical course, she had multiple requests for increases in her pain meds. She requested medications by name, OxyContin, Percocet. In April, she reported increasing anxiety. All right, there's a lot of underlying behavioral stuff here. She had neck pain, 10 out of 10. Now, guys, 10 out of 10 neck pain for a woman's childbirth, labor, no epidural. You can't talk, okay? No imaging was ordered. And by the way, no physical exam was done either. I didn't throw that in there. 1 month later, her neck pain was actually worse than a 10 out of 10. In July, she was crying daily, my life is in complete disarray. Yes, it is. Your patient has underlying behavioral problems and has addictive disease. Recognize it. Slap it in your face. Diversion. Same July, she had a urine drug screen that was negative for Dilaudid. Now, Rob was right. I did go to Crockett, but I did graduate from University High, so I learned how to read and write when I was in the 11th grade. I also learned how to do a little math. Her urine drug screen was negative for hydromorphone Dilaudid. At the time, she was being prescribed 8 milligrams of Dilaudid, number 370 per month. That's 12 pills a day. So I looked at the lab. The texting time was 2 to 4 days. And ciphering that out, she had to skip 24 to 48 pills. Well, you know that. So she's either not having as much pain as you think she is, or she's diverting her medications. Guys, that's the only two options. Didn't follow up on it any further than that. Her prescriptions continued monthly without investigation for possible diversion. Now, guys, that's a big number. I saw everybody's eyes light up. That wasn't all she was getting. That's just one of them. Here's her prescription at the time monthly. Put it all. Stop there. Okay. Guys, that was on one script, right? I mean, I had the script on here for some time, and I took it off because I got scared I was going to violate some kind of HIPAA law. But that's one script, so you can see that. The numbers are just huge. My favorite one out of all that, you know, you see the progression, right? Multiple drugs, and then you got to throw in 2 milligrams of Xanax because at some point you got to go to sleep. And then this was my favorite, Meprigan, Fortis, Demerol, number 60. It says a note, try not to use. Okay, she's a buck 15 soaking wet. Look at all those pills, and that's what the note says. I called up Ken Firstlew, one of my old pharmacology professors. I said, Ken, could she take this, even if she did have that amount of pain, even if she did have that many opiate receptors in her brain? He said, yes, once. Right? Impossible for her to even take that. All right, next slide. Oh, I'm sorry. Guys, that's 1,340 pills a month, 44 pills a day. One script, and it's every month. Next one. Street value. This is the data I pulled this from was CASPR, which is Kentucky's Prescription Monitoring Program. And if you'll flop up the grand total down here, that's $74,740 a month to a lady who's got two small children, ages 6 and 8, and a husband who's beating the crap out of her and not supporting her with child support. Did she have a motive? Of course. Next, it gets better, unfortunately, or worse, depending on how you look at it. May and June that year, her pill counts came up short. In July, her office couldn't reach her for a pill count. When they did reach her, she was on her way to Florida. That's not good there. And this is the saddest part of the case. In June, a year later, her office noted, and this is in the doctor's handwriting, I don't have any other way to know this. Her appearance was very strange today. She was wearing a blonde wig with her natural hair sticking out everywhere. She's wearing dark sunglasses, wearing a long men's shirt with tears in it, and doesn't appear to have on anything underneath it. Guys, that's sad. Our patient, more than likely, is manic. Maybe bipolar, don't know until we get her off all the drugs, or maybe this is just all drugs. Her pill count came up short today. The red writing is mine as I'm going through the chart being a smart aleck because I'm so mad at the doctor by now I can't see straight. And doing these things are really emotional for me. I have to stop and, you know, calm myself down because I want to go kill the sons of bitches. How does the doctor's office respond? Anybody want to guess? That's the story you just got, and you just wrote it yourself. How'd they respond? Evidently, here's the treatment. Oxycontin 80, number 360, Roxycontin number 450, Xanax number 120, Demerol, this time no note. So it's okay to go ahead and take them. And then no urine drug screen was performed. So here's how I reviewed this case. I said that prescribed controlled substances were quantities and frequency inappropriate for a complaint or illness. I never figured out what it was. It was hard to determine what her source of pain was. She had obvious behavioral problems. She was being abused. She had a dramatic and compelling but vague complaint. Go to the next one. She pressured her doctor for increases in her medication. She had a crescendo pattern of drug use with progression of multiple drugs. She asked for drugs by name. She worked in healthcare. Her urine drug screens were inconsistent. Guys, I didn't just look at this and go, this is not within the scope of accepted medical practice. There's 100 reasons. Her pill counts were short. She was either selling them or she was taking more than prescribed. And I said the controlled substances prescribed in this case were outside the scope of accepted medical practice and not for legitimate medical purpose. Does anybody disagree with that? Guys, if you figure out morphine equivalents, and we know that morphine equivalents taking all these drugs with their different potencies and putting them in standardized form, and how many milligrams of morphine equivalents per day they were taking, when you're getting 100 morphine equivalents per day, your risk of overdose, accidental overdose, goes up by 7 to 8 times. At 200, it goes up higher. At 300, it goes even higher. And at 400, it returns almost back down to baseline. Why? Because those are your diverters for the most part. They're not taking it. If you figure out the number of morphine equivalents on that one prescription, it was 2,200. 2,200, not 100. All right. You can roll through this one. This is the police portion of the talk. I get a little fired up there, too. Guys, my resources were off for drug diversion control, NADI, which is National Association of Drug Diversion Investigators, and then the DEA practitioner manual. I didn't make any of this up. And while we go through that case and we look at it and I get on a rant here and there about the treatment, I'm going to continue to stay on that. Because number one on my list is a missed opportunity to help patients. And I'm a patient. And the people in my life helped me. I got world-class treatment. This is my son, senior night at Science Hill. All right, you walk out there with him and, you know, it's an emotional time. Everybody's crying. I'm bawling. But I wasn't bawling because it was last high school game. I was bawling because I damn near missed it. If I didn't have the people in my life I stepped in, I would have missed it. I wouldn't have known the Jim Thibodeaus of the world. Okay, I wouldn't have had the relationships that I have now. I want you to compare me to that woman with 6 and 8, because he was 8 or 9 when I went to treatment, and Haley was 6. I'm the same person as she is. She had this guy. I had Ron Franks, Paul Stanton, Chip Dodd, Roland Gray. Heath got to go to UT to play baseball. It's the first game he got in at third base. And that's me and him in front of his locker. And I'm a huge UT fan, always have been. But I would have missed it all. And look at what I've got to do. I tell everybody I look like Phil Fulmer. That's a bad shot. I stretch the pitcher. I'm really not. That's my argument. So when I hear people say things about some of the drug replacement therapies, it's not ideal. There's a downside to it. There's nothing wrong with keeping people alive. And done the right way, and we introduce cognitive behavioral therapy into that, we can make a huge difference. So don't throw it away just based on what you see. And if you never have any prescription drug overdose talk and be from the state of Tennessee and not talk about the King. The King would have been great in recovery. It would have been great to have him as a spokesman. Unfortunately, nobody stepped in and intervened, and he died. And it's sad. All right, guys, I went a little bit long. I really appreciate your time and attention, and hopefully you got something out of it. I didn't offend you too bad. Thanks.
Please be sure to turn in your credit request forms and your evaluations if you're interested in credit. Thank you.